Hi, my name is Summer L. Williams, and I'm the Associate Artistic Director here at Company One Theater. My pronouns are she, her, hers. Thank you so much for joining us.
And I'm Alana Brownstein, Director of New Work at Company One. My pronouns are she, her, hers. Welcome to Remaking America, an inaugural message to the new administration.
Before we get started, we would like to begin by acknowledging that Company One Theater produces work in Boston, the ancestral and unceded territory of the Wampanoag, Nipmuc, and Massachusetts people. It is important to understand and honor the history of the indigenous land that we occupy and recognize that this acknowledgement is insufficient and does not undo the harm against indigenous people. We continue to take small steps toward a more just future. Thank you.
We're here today to send a message to those in government. In this moment of exceptional social and political turmoil, we remind ourselves that each new president pledges to preserve, protect, and defend. But which communities are at the front of that line? Company One's Surge Lab playwrights, Inda Craig-Galván, Francisca Da Silveira, and Idris Goodwin, demand that we all move to the front by reimagining a better future for housing, health, and education. The resulting plays are accompanied here by conversations with local community leaders who have been doing the work, and action steps that you can take in your own neighborhoods.
As the past few weeks have shown us once again, moving toward change is never light work, but it's always necessary work. When we conceived of this event, we were excited to bring to the front our hope by way of imagining a better future for our country. What we are reminded of now is just how critical this moment is to the reshaping of America, that we can not only imagine a better future, but we can demand one.
This season at Company One, we are thrilled to work with this amazing group of writers who make up the Season 22 Surge Lab, a program that offers micro-commissions to established, civically engaged playwrights to write responsively on social issues. The Surge Lab is part of our larger C1 Playlab circuit, which provides creative and professional development to writers at all stages of their careers.
You are about to experience readings of three short plays that each grapple with a new vision for our country regarding housing, healthcare, and education, core issues for every American. Each playwright received a prompt that included images, articles, and other resources related to these important issues. From there, they each created a 10-minute play and have worked with our awesome creative teams to bring their stories to life.
We'll also be joined by some special guests and partner organizations during the program who will offer some real-world context about the themes of each piece. And because Company One Theater is all about taking action alongside the art, our connectivity team has put together some great ways for you to take action alongside us, so that we can actualize the better future we all so desperately need.
So let's dive in. Without further ado, we give you Remaking America, an inaugural message to the new administration.
Hi, Inda Craig-Galván. My play is Dwelling Codes. The topic is housing inequality, and I chose to write on that because I was inspired by the events that happened here in Los Angeles on Thanksgiving evening, when several families were evicted from houses they were occupying that were owned by the city. And right now, in the middle of a pandemic, in the middle of a pending coup, at the time. We knew it was coming. If you didn't know, come on. But everything happening at the same time just seemed bizarre and inappropriate and apropos, because this is America, and I wanted to write about what that experience was like for the people who were taken out and how people perceived that.
Dwelling Codes by Inda Craig-Galván. Lola hands her cell phone to Coley.
No, you do it.
I've done enough. Haven't I done enough? Besides, they need to see your face.
Oh, you mean my belly.
Don't act like I'm using you.
Aren't you?
We're using what we have.
And that ain't much.
You done?
Am I done? You're seriously asking? How can I be done? I can't be done with this any more than I can just decide not to be pregnant anymore. I think the time for that kind of decision-making is long past. Long past.
Then what is it? What's holding you back now?
I just don't know why you can't do it.
Holy,
we already know your face.
You're worried about face now.
I'm just saying.
So say it. Because so far you aren't. Whole lot of talking and not saying nothing. You're just taking up time.
Ain't that nothing? I thought I was just taking up space.
Space, time, money.
Food, air, life.
Lola places a hand on Coley's belly.
Life.
What if no one sees it? What if they see it, but they don't care? What if we did all this and it doesn't fucking matter?
Lola, more gently this time, offers the phone to Coley. Coley takes it this time.
Go ahead.
Coley taps on the phone, starting a live on social media.
This is Coley.
Just talk. Talk to them.
My name is Coley. Sorry, I'm nervous. I want to be real with you all, but look, it's Thanksgiving. I'm 8.5 months pregnant.
A banging at the door. It startles them both.
Hurry.
We now see Coley in the live that she's recording taking over our screen as if we're watching a live stream on social media.
The sheriff is right outside our door. I'm a part of Reclaim Our Community. It is our door. It's our home. The city knew. We've been living here for months, since May. The mayor knew. Knew the whole time. We're in vacant houses, not bothering anybody. Like, he knew and decided to send the goon squad tonight on Thanksgiving. We're trying to feed our families a Thanksgiving meal, trying to be normal. He knew. And he sent them anyway, strategically. Sent them tonight of all nights in order to send a message, an awful fucking message. They could have come in the daytime. They could have come yesterday, tomorrow, but they're here right now. Tonight. Where are we gonna go now? At night? In a pandemic? Like, come on, this was intentional. This was a...
The lights come up on Francis outside of the house 30 minutes later. Flashes of cameras, murmurs of other reporters, whirr of a low-flying news helicopter. This is a scoop.
It is cold outside tonight, Lance. I'm not sure why the sheriff's office chose tonight for these evictions. Francis Corman reporting live on Thanksgiving night. But I do know that I'll be thankful to be in my warm home tonight. Get it? Because it's Thanksgiving. It's fucking Thanksgiving. Where? What? I didn't realize we were... So sorry. That was just a... Yes, Lance, these removals, of course, go against the city's moratorium on evictions during the pandemic. And the city says that the houses are uninhabitable. that they don't meet dwelling codes. And the city, so one would surmise, as members of Reclaim Our Community must have assumed, free housing for everyone, yay. Or, sorry, that, fuck. I'm sorry, Lance. I just keep rolling, Raymond. You didn't cut before. Don't you cut now. They offered to put the houses into the land trust, just like they did in Oakland, California. It worked there. Why wouldn't our mayor let these people do the same thing here? I mean, seriously, we're in a goddamn pandemic. And they pulled a pregnant woman out, dragged her ass out here and tossed her on the fucking curb. Fuck.
Francis throws the mic. Probably hits Raymond. The camera falls to the ground. Back inside the house. 6 months earlier, May 2020. A bright, happy afternoon, even for 2020. A fresh cut watermelon sits on the dining table, along with a pitcher and glasses of fresh, cold lemonade. Summery stuff. Moving boxes stacked up against one wall. The room is even sparser than the last time we saw it. Coley sits across the table from Mimi.
You've got a lot to celebrate, huh?
Mm-hmm.
New baby on the way, new house. I didn't even know there were houses over here.
So, how long have you been a doula?
3 years now. And I apprenticed. Shadowed for two. You're in good hands.
Good. Okay, good.
How much? Hope you don't mind me asking. It's so quiet over here.
Is there a contract or something?
Your first, right?
What?
Your first baby? You've got the get-to-it symptoms a first-time mom has. No small talk. Where's the contract? I've seen that before. Oh. See it all the time.
Yeah. Sorry.
Can I get you some lemonade? Mother's got to stay hydrated, right?
Thank you.
Mimi pours Coley a glass and refills their own. Mimi notices the framed photos on the wall. They hand the glass to Coley, but holds on to it.
People know I'm here.
Excuse me?
You don't live here, but you called me here. I'm just letting you know, people know I'm here. I don't go anywhere without having some backup.
No, it's not like that.
Then what's it like? You know what? I don't need to know. I'm out.
We're occupying. It's not our house.
We who?
Me and my partner, Lola. She's not here right now. I promise we're not up to anything.
Anything other than taking someone's house?
It's no one's home.
You killed that family on the wall?
I guess that's who lived here before the city took it. I don't know. Can you just...
It's the hormones. It's okay.
What have I done? What the hell am I doing here?
Sounds like you were desperate. Or tired.
But tired of being tired.
I know that feeling. But you're standing up for something. That must feel good, right? For a while.
You know what's in that box?
Yeah, a crib.
How'd you know?
I'm a doula. Coley, are you and Lola?
Lola.
Are you and Lola on the lam now? That why you aren't going to a real doctor?
Nothing feels safe now.
Absolutely nothing. We're living in hell. But you know, doulas do keep records, right? We're not off the grid.
Oh.
Yeah, no, we're not like mob doctors or vets you go to for pain meds when you get shot or when that happens on TV. I don't know if that happens in real life. I don't know. I deliver babies.
Yeah.
Mimi takes Coley's glass.
And I look out for mothers.
Yeah.
Coley, are you safe here with Lola?
For a while.
What are you going to do when they...
Thank you for coming.
Mimi puts a business card on the table and exits. Coley goes to the big box that holds the crib. Lola enters through the front door.
I'm home. Coley? Was someone here?
The doula. Do you see them?
I saw the melted ice in two glasses. How'd it go? Seems solid? You want to meet with a few more?
It was fine. Did you say melted?
Probably because it's so hot in here. I told you to keep the curtains drawn. That sun.
Sorry.
Don't apologize to me.
Are we safe?
Did you say something about how we acquired this house?
Acquired? That's nice. That's real nice, Lola.
So you did say something. And now this stranger comes in here and...
I'm pregnant, Lola.
We're pregnant.
No. Technically, no, I'm pregnant. I'm emotional and hormonal and nauseated and swollen and strong and... weak and smarter and more sensitive and weaker and I'm putting two bodies in this fight.
You want to leave?
Leave you? Never. And I want to fight, I do.
But? Coley, tell me what you want.
Food? Air? Life? You? This crib, I want to put this crib together.
Yeah?
I'll keep the curtains closed tomorrow.
I'll be here to remind you.
Yeah?
I need to spend some more time here. Fix this house up.
Lola looks at the crib instructions.
Oh, it's a lot.
We'll get it done.
Hello? What happens when they come?
They won't. Or it'll be like in Oakland. It'll be fine. We're gonna make that little one proud. Change some shit in this country.
Can we unpack the kitchen in the morning?
Of course. Nausea passing?
Maybe.
Good. Come here. I need to see your face.
They hold on to each other. Lights fade. End of play.
Hi, my name is Jessie Baxter. I use she, her, hers pronouns, and I'm the business manager and creative producer at Company One. And I'm so glad today to be joined by Carolyn from Asian American Resource Workshop. Welcome.
Thanks. Thanks so much for having me, Jessie.
We are really excited to have you on this project because we've partnered a few times now. So some folks who are watching might be a little bit familiar with some of the work that you've done in relation to immigration and deportation issues. But that's only part of what ARW does. So I was wondering if you could start by telling us a little bit about sort of the broad work that you do and the work that you do specific to housing, because that's what we're going to talk about here today.
Yeah. My name's Carolyn Chu. I use she, her pronouns. I'm the executive director at the Asian American Resource Workshop, as Jessie said. And ARW, we're a pan-Asian member-based community organizing group. And we organize the diversity of the Asian American community around issues of displacement. So for us, that means housing and gentrification, immigration, deportation, and criminalization and surveillance. So all of the many ways that folks are removed from our communities and not able to participate in building the thriving, healthy communities we know our working class neighborhoods deserve. We do a lot of work specifically in Fields Corner, Dorchester, which is the heart of the Vietnamese community here in Boston and is also a multiracial working class and rapidly gentrifying neighborhood. So through our work here in Fields Corner, as well as organizing our base of Asian Americans across the city, we are part of many coalitions and different campaigns to really fight for the kind of housing we know our folks need across the city and state. So that includes eviction defense and making sure folks can stay in their homes now, as well as advocating for policy and transformative change to the way new housing is built and making sure it's actually affordable for people and is permanently affordable, and making sure residents have a voice in those processes, in decision-making, in what the future of housing in our neighborhoods looks like. And so just to kind of close the little summary, we are really proud to be a big support and anchor of Dorchester Not For Sale, which is a neighborhood formation here in Fields Corner, a multiracial neighborhood formation that's really been focusing on these issues, both of planning and equitable development here in our changing neighborhood, as well as making sure, you know, all residents are able to stay and are not getting evicted, which obviously is what the play referenced and is something we're seeing every day in Boston, across Massachusetts, and of course, across the country.
Absolutely. So you have a little bit of a video snippet that you're gonna share with us. Do you wanna tell us a bit about what we're gonna see?
Yeah, so this video is from Dorchester Not For Sale, our multiracial community of residents who have been advocating for equitable development and real community planning and real community voice. So the video is from 2 years ago, and it was specific to a development that was coming to the neighborhood that is now being built, and really asking the question of who is new development being built for, right? And so while, you know, in this COVID moment, in this crisis moment, we're seeing folks being pushed out of their units every day, right? As this place so beautifully and tragically depicted. And we also know planning for the future, more development is still coming. And we wanna make sure that both folks can stay here now and folks can stay here in the future. So this is kind of giving a flavor of some of our organizing around these future developments while understanding that if people can't stay right now, you know, how are they gonna be able to be part of building those communities and building this future?
All right, so let's check it out.
And I'm poor, and my community is poor. And if you build this, I don't know where we're gonna go, because we already left a home in Vietnam once, and now we have to leave again.
My name is Jose Pash. I'm from Chester.
d'orchestre, je ne tiens pas de temps pour lire, que non, je suis destin, donc je suis en autre lugar. Le projet est très bonito. Mas a mim, mais coisa que me crê é que para o que me ensata hoje é escrever de maneira que escrever trano de ler para outro alguém bem que lê que é certo.
I was wondering if you could kind of build off of what we just saw and talk a little bit about some of the pressing issues that you're seeing in your work as it relates to COVID and more generally around the housing and eviction crisis.
Yeah, well, I actually wanted to start by referencing a few things that I think that the play brought up that I think really highlight what we're seeing here in Dorchester. And I know what our partners are seeing across the city and state. One is that evictions continue to happen, right? Even though we have had some protections over this period, folks are still being pushed out legally or illegally from their units. We hear about that all the time with Vietnamese immigrant residents and other residents here in the neighborhood. So it's a big concern. How do we make sure that our city, state, and federal government are protecting folks and that those protections are being enforced, right? Because even as said in the play, even with a federal eviction moratorium, people are still having landlords knock on their doors, throw their stuff on the streets. That's happening all around us, right? So it's critical that in this public health emergency, folks are able to stay in their homes, in their units. And then, you know, also just to raise, I think this is really a gender justice issue, right? We see women, mothers bearing the brunt of this crisis, right? Of the, you know, jobs, childcare, all of that, and housing, right? Having stable housing for your family, for your children is such a key piece. So just wanted to lift that up in the way.
Absolutely.
This is, you know, these issues intersect. And then I think, you know, there's the eviction piece, there's the immediate, right? We have to stop the crisis. But we know that, you know, just whenever the state of emergency is lifted, that the crisis in our communities will continue and has, you know, been an issue prior to COVID. And so in the play, they reference land trusts. And you know, I think to us, it's really, how do we get land off the speculative housing market now? How do we, and in the future, how do we get community control of land and more affordability in new development? So land trusts are one way to have community ownership of land, but how are we, you know, taking this time to really reimagine our housing system that works so that it works for folks, right? That we can really have homes for all. And you know, I think this moment really pushes us. If folks don't have a house, home, a place to live, how can they be safe in this moment? And that's true beyond COVID, right? So how do we really use this as a point to move forward and say, we're gonna prioritize affordable, truly affordable housing for everyone in our communities. And we want to make sure that the community has a voice and a say and control in the future of housing and development.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting to me, you kind of, if you place like the kind of COVID map of the city on top of the mm-hmm. areas that are being super gentrified and like where a housing crisis is sort of like the most dire, I think that it's not a coincidence that those things kind of overlap really significantly.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, just, I think it continues to push us to understand how, and for policy to really understand how all of these systemic issues are connected, right? How immigration and housing and, you know, policing and all of these things are deeply intertwined. And we need to make policy changes in every arena, but we just have to understand it's all connected. And yeah, just as you said, all of these maps overlay on each other, and there's a reason, right? It's around systemic racism and us really reckoning with that.
Yeah. So there's a lot of challenges ahead and a lot of work to be done. But I'm curious about sort of what you see in the next 4 years as we sort of go into this new administration. What are the opportunities that you're maybe hoping come to light through the transfer of who's in the White House? And you know, what challenges do we think are gonna continue and kind of need to be chipped away at you know, ongoing in an ongoing way.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, on the federal level, the big thing that comes down around housing is money for affordable housing, right? We need real investment from the federal, state, and city level to build the kind of affordable housing that we know residents need. So that's huge, and will be, there'll be so much more opportunity for that in the next period, as well as issues of fair housing, right, and racial segregation, and maintaining affirmatively furthering fair housing standards, you know, making sure we don't gut all of those protections, and public housing, you know, that being something that needs to continue to be funded and is so critical for so many people in our communities. And so, you know, I think there's a lot of opportunity to really get more funding in, and that will be huge for these new developments to really start to meet the mark of what the real incomes of residents in the neighborhoods are. And obviously, you know, now we will also be entering a new period in city government connected to that. And so I'm really hoping that in the next period, we continue to build on opportunities to move the really creative housing solutions like community land trusts that we re-envision planning and development to meet residents' needs and be grounded in decision-making of residents. And that, yeah, we continue to protect folks and to keep them in their homes, to stop speculation by corporate landlords, and, you know, to really put forward a vision of housing for everyone in our communities and to do everything we can to make that a reality.
Yeah. Well, I think it's gonna take a lot of us kind of holding some folks to account to make all those things happen. And so I'm curious if you can talk a little bit about how people can maybe stay informed on some of these issues over the next coming years, because there's a lot going on. And if people have maybe heard some of the different topics that we've touched on so far and want to dig deeper, I'd love to point folks towards some resources.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, as I mentioned earlier, we are just one part of many powerful organizations who've been working around housing justice across Boston and across the state of Massachusetts. So there's a website, homesforallmass.org. And on that website, you can find out all about the state policy we're pushing and about the different groups across the state that are organizing those most impacted and everyday people around housing justice. So, you know, none of us could do it alone. And it's really in all coming together across difference, across different racial ethnic communities, right? Centering BIPOC folks, centering working class folks, that we're able to make change at the neighborhood level, city and state. And so that's a really good place to get information about what's moving at the state level and what might be moving in your city or town across the state.
Awesome. We'll be sure to put that in the chat so folks can go ahead and hop over to that site right away and get informed. And thank you so much for joining us today to share a little bit about your work. You're doing just awesome, really important stuff with ARW. We're so pleased to be able to partner with you again. And I'm sure there'll be plenty more times in the future. So I look forward to those future partnerships. And thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Jesse, and thanks everyone for being here.
My name is Francisca Da Silveira, and my pronouns are she, her, hers. The title of my play is Inside Out, and it deals with themes of mental health and healthcare. As someone who has lived with anxiety and depression for the majority of my life, I feel like everything I write somehow touches on mental health. For better or worse, right now, our idea of normal has just been completely dismantled, both because of the pandemic and because of the precarious state of our government. We have to be able to talk about how both of those impact our mental and physical wellness, and we have to individually and as a society figure out how to move forward. But before we can do that, we also have to reckon with our history and our complicity and the ways that all of it just lives in our body and causes us damage. It is not an easy thing for anyone to do, let alone someone who may have a mental or physical health issue. It's something that you have to live with and try to work out day by day and minute by minute.
Inside Out by Francisca Da Silveira. A bedroom. Blackout curtains are drawn, disguising mess. Books, wrinkled clothes, empty Chipotle containers, and many, many, many plants. Snake, spider, parlor palm, monstera, weeping fig, jade, red prayer, fiddle leaves, happy beam, aloe vera, and a lucky bamboo. All of various shapes, all of various sizes, all in various states of life and death. Tasha under blankets on the bed. The only light is from the open laptop next to her. A distorted voice from a dream state that sounds remarkably like her sister Dawn.
Are you still watching us
here? Tasha shifts, still distorted, but clearer.
Are you still watching?
Tasha shifts, less distorted, clearer.
Are you still watching?
Tasha shifts, no distortion, clear, like the person is in the room.
Are you still watching? Tasha. Tasha.
Oh my God, what?
Don't talk to me like that. Are you still watching this thing?
Yes.
Really? What episode are you on?
The one where they just leave me alone and go away. Yeah.
I heard that one got terrible ratings.
Dawn opens a curtain, light streams in, showing daylight and mess.
Oh, Dawn, come on, man. Why you gotta be like that?
Why do you gotta live like a vampire in those Twilight books you used to be obsessed with?
We don't talk about that anymore.
Hmm. Oh, and obviously we don't shower either, or clean, or...
Respect privacy. And how'd you even get in here? I know I locked the door.
I don't know how you're getting away with locking doors in Mama's house.
I'm a grown-ass woman, okay? And if I lock a door, I'll lock a door.
She's been too busy working to notice, huh?
That too. Look, whatever. Can you go now? I was finally drifting off.
Tasha settles back in. Dawn picks up a spray bottle filled with water.
Why does it look like I'm in the Amazon forest right now?
Oh my God, Dawn, leave me the fuck alone.
What did you just say to me?
Dawn pulls the covers off of Tasha and sprays the shit out of her.
What are you doing? Stop! Stop it! Yo, stop! Ma! Ma!
Ma's not here. And shut up before you wake my baby up.
What? The baby's here too?
Duh. What you think? I'm gonna leave my newborn baby at home alone.
Can I see him?
I just told you he's sleeping.
I'll be quiet.
We got more important things to deal with, Natasha. Like, why you're still sleeping at 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
It's 3 already?
Yes, it's 3 already. I know you're not working right now, but that's no reason to be wasting away in here. Especially not when Ma's risking her life at the post office day in and out. You could at least...
You just came here to lecture me?
Yes, in fact, I did just come here to lecture you. Least you could do is clean up in here acting like a dirty 14-year-old boy.
You've made your point, Dawn. Repeatedly. In excess. Overstated.
The sisters square off. Dawn relents.
Why you got a closet full of my clothes and you're gonna just choose to hide that cute body underneath an ugly sweater 10 times your size?
I like this sweater. It's warm.
Again, we're clearly living in the Amazon forest right now. It's so stuffy in here.
Leave my plant babies alone.
You could get you a real baby if you wore some of my hoochie dresses. Used to love trying them on.
I don't want a real baby. I don't ever plan on having kids.
You say that now. Just wait until...
Not now, not ever.
Well, okay then. Plant babies it is. Although some of them are looking a little sad.
Tasha snatches the spray bottle from Donna and starts spraying plants.
They say periodic sunlight also helps.
Oh, I'll take that into consideration.
Dawn picks up a crystal.
You messing with this witchcraft stuff now too?
Yo, put that down.
What? Am I stealing your chi or something?
That's not how it works.
Got a yoga mat? Candles? What is this? Are you smoking now?
It's sage, and I don't remember you being this nosy.
All this sleeping in has got your memory twisted. I was always this nosy.
I wasn't sleeping in. I was taking a nap.
What you need a nap for? You're not a toddler, and it's not like you got a job to tire you out.
Okay, first of all, stop bringing up my unemployment. It's not like it's by choice. And second of all, napping is a form of resistance.
I'm sorry, what?
Yeah, I'm healing my body.
Did you just push a 10-pound baby out of your vagina?
No.
Then what do you need to heal from?
Trauma. Grief. Lives in the body.
Is this that depression thing again?
Cool. That's really cool, Don. Thank you.
You were sleeping a lot back then, too.
Well, this is different.
You still seeing that white lady?
My therapist?
Yeah.
No.
Why not?
I don't trust white women anymore.
I mean, I don't know why you ever did, but wasn't she helping you?
Yeah. No, I don't know. It doesn't matter anyway.
If she was helping you, then you should call her.
I can't.
Why is it always I can't with you? Grow up, Tosh. Show a little positivity.
My new insurance doesn't cover it. Not even virtual or phone calls. And I can't exactly afford to pay for someone either, especially right now. Since I don't have a history of taking medication, because according to Ma, Black people don't get depressed, they won't even book me for a psychiatrist. And again, don't trust white women, and most of the psychiatrists are just that, so no thank you to all of it.
Can't you go see your PCP at least?
Well, I also don't trust doctors anymore, and I don't have a PCP.
What do you mean you don't have a PCP?
Weren't you listening? Had to switch insurance.
So?
So, all of this shit is so confusing. Like, they deliberately make it so hard to figure any of it out online, and then they're just rude to you and impatient when you're on the phone that you eventually are just like, fuck it, I give up, and you just hope you don't trip and break a bone or catch COVID. So, yeah. That's why I'm perfectly fine just staying my ass in bed with my plants and my crystals and my sage until the rest of the world stop being so fucking hard to navigate because white people just want to weed us out.
Here we go with that shit.
That shit is reality. You should know, Donna. If you had a Black doctor...
You think a Black doctor would have listened to me any more than a white one?
Yeah, I actually do. They would have listened to you and... You'd still be here.
I don't want to talk about this. I came to have a nice visit with my baby sister, but girl, you are bringing me the fuck down.
You are stressing me the fuck out.
It smells like Cheez-Its in here. Where's the Febreze?
I don't know.
Tasha gets back in bed. Dawn looks for the Febreze.
You gotta find some joy, Tasha.
I am so tired of everyone using that damn word. Why do I gotta be joyful? Like, why do I have to prove to other people that I am joyful?
What's one piece of joy you're finding in this moment?
Why do you wanna know? Like, why are you so concerned? Just focus on your own. God, if one more white person asked me that question in the interview, I'm gonna lose it more than I apparently already have. It's like some Get Out type shit. Like, why do you want to know? So you can suck that from me too? Just take that from me too? What more is there to take? There is so little left to take.
So what are you gonna do then? Hibernate until we have universal healthcare so you can start seeing someone again?
Sounds like a plan to me.
Well, you can't, okay? I am not gonna let that happen. You've got a whole life left to live. What do you want to do with it? It can't be this. It cannot be this. What do you want to do with your life? Tell me, because it cannot be this. I won't allow it. No. What do you want? Tell me.
I just want to stay alive.
Tasha, you're not dying.
I could.
You won't.
You did.
I think the baby's crying.
I don't hear anything.
I'm a mom. I've got supersonic hearing. I should go check.
No, don't go.
You were just begging me to leave.
You were asking me what I wanted earlier, and I said I wanted to stay alive, but I lied. What I really want is for you to come back.
He's getting really loud, Tasha. I gotta go check on him.
No, I don't hear anything.
I told you a mother knows.
Are you gonna come back after?
Of course I am.
You promise?
Why are you so needy all of a sudden?
I don't trust anyone anymore. With everything happening right now, with losing you, with losing work, losing outside, losing truth, losing literally everything. I don't trust a goddamn person because everyone just wants to play pretend. Everyone wants to be distracted. Like when finally we have a chance to just slow the fuck down and sleep and heal ourselves properly. To look at everything that has fucked us for centuries and say no more, but that involves acknowledging it. For real, it involves looking our loss in the face. Like I'm doing with you right now.
Why would anyone want to live in loss?
Because that's how we heal. From the inside out. Right now, it's all outside in and surface. It's all talk about going back to normal, but I can't do that. I won't survive normal again, Don. I won't.
Tosh, listen to me, okay?
Okay.
You're listening?
Yeah, I'm listening.
Are you still watching?
What?
A distorted voice from a dream state that sounds remarkably like her sister Dawn.
Are you still watching?
Tasha, alone, in darkness, a mess, under blankets on the bed. She wakes. The only light is from the open laptop next to her, knocking on the door.
Tasha, are you still sleeping? Little girl, you best get out of bed. And where the hell did this lock come from?
And
hi, I'm Jessie here again. So glad to be joined by Marlene Boyette to talk about some self-care and talk through a little bit of a grounding exercise that we're going to do all together in the digital space. So welcome, Marlene. So glad to have you with us.
Thank you, Jessie. I'm really, really excited to be with you today.
Absolutely. So Marlene, I would love if you could just give us a little bit of an overview of the work that you do and sort of the philosophy of your practice within the wellness space.
Sure. So I am a wellness practitioner, yoga and meditation instructor residing in Boston and Jamaica Plain to be specific. I've been teaching since 2016 and I've been personally practicing since about 2003. I teach full-time at the Advent School. So I'm their in-house yoga and meditation instructor. And I also teach yoga with Four Corners Yoga and Wellness in Dorchester. And in terms of my philosophy, I do believe that wellness and self-care are radical acts and that everyone deserves access to these things. I believe that, you know, practicing self-care and like really getting into focusing on wellness is a way to resist a lot of society's push to be nothing but like a productive machine. So I really try to like you know, encourage people to slow down a little bit and to really reconnect with themselves, reconnect with their breath, and, you know, settle in.
Yeah, I feel like that. So this this kind of notion of radical self-care is one that I think ties super directly into the play that we just saw. And I was wondering if you can talk a little bit more about the ways that yoga and mindfulness sort of intersect with social justice as we think about, you know, access to these sorts of practices on a broad level and how that intersects with sort of the healthcare space in a kind of bigger umbrella way.
Sure. So I mean, personally, I believe that everyone deserves access to, you know, self-care and wellness services. I think that many times they're not accessible because of, you know, location or price or, you know, various things that impact people and that make the divide, you know, even broader. But learning how to practice these things for yourself, understanding that you don't necessarily have to be within a yoga studio or, you know, have access to certain like clothing in order to practice these things is really important. And I feel that the average person doesn't really, I think when you first are imagining wellness or self-care, that you're not envisioning it as something that you can do or that happens off of a mat, right? That we're thinking yoga, we're not thinking about, you know, being mindful in the way that you're eating or mindful in the way that you experience your day and just slowing down to really be present. So I think that these small understandings or like coming to smaller ways that you can practice allows you to incorporate it more into your daily life, which then allows you to actually embody these things and not look at them as inaccessible.
Can you talk a little bit about kind of what is so important about taking time to do this, especially when things are like as challenging as they are on a day-to-day level right now?
Sure. I think that given everything that is going on, I mean, we're in the midst of a health pandemic. And also I think in many ways, like to be completely honest, a racial pandemic, you know? And so these are stresses that people are feeling like very deeply in their bodies, like in their minds, like in their spirits. And so being able to ground yourself, right? Like being able to feel safe in your body and stable in your body allows you to regulate your thoughts. It allows you to regulate like your central nervous system. So you're regulating your emotions and you're able to process things a little bit better. This pandemic has been extremely stressful on people. Folks are, you know, losing access to their employment. Folks are being like ousted from their homes, being evicted. And these are extremely like traumatic situations. Like all of this is trauma. And so being able to be present with yourself to at least at the minimum, being able to reconnect with your breath, right? Your breathing so that you can access some peacefulness for yourself. Can really shift the way that you are processing all the things that are happening around you.
Yeah. All right, so Marlene, can you talk to us a little bit about what we're about to experience as our self-care intermission for the program tonight and tell us what the exercise is that you're about to lead us through?
Absolutely. So I am going to chime these singing bowls, which are Tibetan singing bowls, and I'm going to walk folks through a head to toe body scan and grounding exercise. While I'm cueing through it, I'll cue people to be seated. But if folks wanted to do this like outside of this recording, it's definitely something that you can do while standing or seated or even laying down. You could be at the bus stop, you could be in the shower. It's something that you can do anywhere.
Awesome. So we'll transition to that in just a moment. But before we do, I just want to say thank you so much for joining us, Marlene. It's been great to hear a little bit about your work. And I'm so excited to have everybody kind of take a moment of self-care before we move on to the rest of our program tonight. So thanks so much for joining us.
Absolutely, Jesse. Thank you for having me. So I'll invite you first to come to a comfortable seated position. You could also lay down if you have access to a surface. We'll begin with you opening your mouth slightly so that your lips are not pressed together and so that your jaw can begin to soften. If it feels comfortable for you to close your eyes, you can also feel free to close your eyes. Or you could simply settle your gaze on the floor or on the surface directly in front of you. I'll begin by chiming the singing bowls, inviting you to tune into the sound. Try not to judge them, but simply notice what's on your mind. Next, I'll invite you to move your attention into your face, envisioning the various points of your face as soft. Your brow line, your eye sockets, your cheekbones, your jaw, your lips, and even your tongue, all becoming softer. Gently begin to move your attention from your mouth and your tongue into your throat and your neck, envisioning them too as soft. Coming further down to your shoulder blades, your collarbone, maybe rolling your shoulders back a few times and envisioning this portion of your body as soft as well. Coming down into your arms, acknowledging the muscles in your arms, your elbows, your forearms, and even your wrists as soft. Envision the tops of your hands, the palms of your hands, your fingers, as soft. Maybe even spread your fingers apart so that you can feel the webbing between them and bring your attention all the way to your fingertips, seeing them as soft as well. Drawing your attention back up your arms to the center of your collarbone, radiating into your chest, noticing how you feel in this moment emotionally. Envisioning your heart as soft. Any feelings that you may be holding or carrying as soft. Maybe deepening your breath if that feels right to you. Then moving your awareness down to your belly, envisioning your belly as soft, coming down to your hips and your pelvis and envisioning them too as soft, coming down into your legs, noticing the front and the back as soft, your knees, your calves and shins, even your ankles, as soft. Noting the tops of your feet, the soles of your feet, even your toes, all becoming softer. You could spread your toes apart if you like, bringing your awareness all the way to the tips of your toes before moving your attention to the rear of your body at the top of your spine. From the top of your spine, begin to deepen your breath as though you're creating space between each part of your spine, each vertebrae. And as you move your breath and your attention down your spine, envision even your spine as soft. When you come to your lower back, expand your breath, taking a full breath in through your nose, letting out an audible exhale as though your breath were wrapping around your lower back. Then gently return your attention, return your breath to the front of your body, to your heart space, continuing to soften there. Noting that you can exhale and release anything that you're holding emotionally that you don't wish to carry. Then gently transitioning your attention from your heart back to the crown of your head, envisioning your thoughts as soft. Taking a moment to note your body's connection to the surface where you sit. Gently rolling your shoulders back, acknowledging your breath's presence within your body. Noting that you are safe and grounded and soft.
Is Idris Goodwin, he, him, his. I'm from Colorado Springs, Colorado, the unceded territory of the Ute and the Cheyenne. My play for this amazing project is called The Miseducation of Drea and Lon. My theme was education. And as a parent with a son who was, whose, you know, educational trajectory, he's in the third grade now, was definitely disrupted by the pandemics. We're having a lot of conversations around not just about health, but also beginning to question, you know, the educational system as we know it. You know, my wife and I both had very different experiences in education. And, you know, together we're trying to coalesce the best of our both experiences and his experience. And so I wanted to kind of write a play, just a small moment, a small snapshot of, you know, parents of color, you know, navigating and asking a lot of these questions about, you know, what does it mean to be educated properly and how do we best prepare, you know, our children for the world.
The Miseducation of Lon and Drea by Idris Goodwin.
But we turned out okay.
You want okay for your son.
You know what I mean.
I want best. We are going to strive for the best. That's what we owe him.
We owe him an education.
Not just any old kind of education.
Do you think I am saying any old kind? I know not any old kind.
This is his whole life. And it's these first few years that are so crucial.
I know. And again, I say, you and I both got public educations and we're okay. We went to our neighborhood schools. We walked to and from. Kids we saw at school were right up the street from us. We didn't have to do play dates. We just walked outside on a Saturday.
Our parents chose that for us. But this is our child and our choice.
And I choose the neighborhood school.
And I don't.
Why not?
Because.
It's a perfectly good school.
Good is not perfect, is it?
You know what I mean.
I want close to perfection.
And that's Cambridge. Cambridge is perfection?
Better than his neighborhood school.
Based on what criteria?
You've seen the ratings.
The Rotten Tomatoes of education websites? You realize that's an AI, right? That creates those ratings, right? They don't take into account all the variables.
Scores, curriculum, recommendations. These are not arbitrary.
Freya.
I know. We both went to neighborhood schools, but how much did you need to relearn and unlearn after you graduated high school?
Well, no matter where we send him, he will have to unlearn.
Yeah, but not as much as we did. The neighborhood schools still be dressing kids up in paper bags and feathers for Thanksgiving, skimming past Tubman, Malcolm X, never mention Cesar Chavez or Dolores Huerta.
That's our job.
No, that's their job. I mean, it's our job, but it's their job too. And homeboy trying to make it illegal for these types of people to be taught.
Ah, that's a publicity stunt.
He's not acting alone. They have been after ethnic studies and Black history forever. You see how they came for Homegirl after a 1619 project. Lost their damn minds.
I know.
It is our job. It is. But why not send him someplace that makes our lift lighter?
Cambridge teaching ethnic studies in white and Black history to mostly white kids, though. And wait, did I say mostly? I mean, all.
It's not all white.
1% other.
I know.
Yeah, and the Rotten Tomatoes of education website don't factor cultural diversity, does it? So what's better? Send them someplace where they talk the talk, but don't really walk the walk? Reading about Black folks instead of seeing them every day?
And Asian folks and Latinx folks.
Yeah. I know.
Diverse experience.
My point exactly. I mean, look, Cambridge is very, very nice, but it's about as diverse as a Toy Story movie.
The toys don't have races.
Sure they do. Woody Why, Buzz Why, Bo Peep, white.
Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head are brown.
Potatoes don't have a race. I'm talking about the people toys. No Black, Latinx, or Asian people toys.
That's true.
So?
I don't remember what I was thinking now. You got me thinking about the race of people toys.
We don't have to decide this now. Be online till next fall.
But we want to know now.
I pick neighborhood school.
It's not like I don't have my reservations about Cambridge.
Sure.
It's a lot to ask of a brown child to navigate that. Mm. And not that it matters, but yeah, that price tag is hefty.
Thank you.
I think we could still qualify for the aid they offer.
And the Melanated Scholarship Program.
Shut up.
What? Isn't that what it's called? If they were honest, that's what they call it.
What if we homeschool them?
Hmm?
Yeah.
We're homeschooling him now.
Sort of.
These teachers got thrown a mud ball to manage. You know, they need the parents to make the thing go right.
I'm talking top to bottom, though. Homeschooled top to bottom. It could be great. Think about it.
I am, and I don't think it's a good idea.
You could teach the history. You love history.
B being taught history, not teaching it. We can't do this.
Sure, we can.
Respectfully, I don't think you're really thinking this through.
That's what I am doing right now with you. We are thinking it through.
Freya.
You're bowing out?
I have a job. So do you.
Educating him is also our job. It's like you said.
And then
it's our job to make sure he knows Tubman and King and Truth and X and everybody in between.
We ain't educators.
But aren't we?
Yes. But no, like he has to go to school.
Let's take him to school.
But he needs other kids. That's how he's gonna learn.
We'll sign him up for stuff.
Stuff?
Extracurricular stuff.
That's not the same.
As what? Being crammed in a hot box with 22 others, vying for the teacher's attention?
Vying is a skill he'll need.
If we switch him to homeschool now, then there will be no disruption when school may or may not return. We set him on a path.
We got vaccines. We'll be gathering again soon.
When?
Soon.
But we could set him on a course right now. Right now.
We have time to decide.
This is a good idea.
To you. You're not thinking about how much work it... People train to become teachers, you know.
You're forgetting something really, really, really important.
Am I?
Yes. You are forgetting that I'm a mother.
That you are.
It's like an inalienable right. It's like the inalienable rights we are all born with. We have the inalienable duty to educate our own child. They watch us, model us, parrot us, what we value, what we ignore.
But doesn't it also take a village?
We can design curriculums over the weekend.
Well, then when do we get a weekend?
When he graduates.
You're tripping.
2, maybe 3 hours at the most, and the more we do it, the easier it'll get.
Listen, this might sound, I don't mean to be, because I know there are exceptions, but homeschool kids are kind of...
Do you know any homeschool kids? Like, for real?
Oh, I've met some.
Ew, stop. Don't talk like that.
Prejudice? Does that sound prejudice? I'm obviously not being prejudiced.
Doesn't seem obvious.
You said he learns from what we value, right? Mm-hmm. Public education is an amazing social program at its core, right? And it's still got something to offer, a lot to fix, especially after old what's-her-face, old Petty Betty and President Conman, but Jane Addams and her crew had the right idea. We keep him here every day. How will he learn to negotiate others? I know we are great to be around, but he needs to experience the world without us. And after all this time in quarantine with us and our issues and gripes, he'll need it.
I don't think I'm okay.
Huh?
You and I went to neighborhood schools and you think we came out okay. I didn't. I just survived. I just endured in spite of it. My high school had metal detectors. We had 27 to a class, 4 years of stress. They taught me such lies. I spent my first 2 years of undergrad trying to catch up to everyone. But more than that, I never felt like I mattered there. I felt like a number. They just pumped me full of tests. And you see how vulnerable it all is, sways with the winds of political parties, the petty betties of the world who don't even send their own kids to public schools. It's that vulnerability. I can't take it. And you know this as a parent, right?
I do.
You are so vulnerable every day. So I will do anything I can to make him strong. I will make the curriculums and sign him up for the extracurricular stuff and do whatever needs doing.
Home will always be his safety. We're supposed to be his constant. But we can't replicate the world in here.
I don't want to replicate the world. I want to remake it. Tell me honestly, do you really think you came out okay?
They hear something and turn their attention to someone we can't see.
Hey!
Hey, baby. Did you just log off?
Good day.
We were just talking about you and your school and next fall.
When you'll be back in person.
We have a question for you. You get to choose. Do you want to go to the neighborhood school with the kids who live around you? Or do you want to go to a really special school?
Kind of like Hogwarts, but no magic, just uniforms.
Or do you want to stay here and learn with us? We'd be your teachers every day.
Kind of like now.
But different. And you'd have some extracurricular activities.
So,
what do you want? Outside? Yeah, we can go outside.
Outside sounds perfect.
End of play.
I hope you enjoyed Miss Education. We are joined by Aya, and I will let him introduce himself.
Yes, my name is Aya Josiah-Faeduwor. Pronouns are he, series. I am a Boston, originally from Boston, but a Providence, Rhode Island resident, and thoroughly enjoyed the play, and very excited to have this conversation about a deep passion of mine, which is, you know, education in the in urban communities, thinking about the education of marginalized folks, in particular folks of color, from low-income communities. Very excited for this dialogue with you, Summer.
What are some ways or strategies, what could we do to maybe avoid needing to have some of the conversations that we watch those parents have? Or how might we think about the way we can get active in our communities and look at really addressing the disparities that we know exist, but very often it's the people of color who are naming them?
Yeah, I mean, that's such an important question. I think the second part of the question, the answer is in like kind of the first thing that you were speaking to, which is, you know, what is the purpose of school? And the public education system, the original goal was to prepare students to be, you know, engaged citizens. You know, it's a pathway to learn about, you know, how the world works, so you can then contribute as a voter, as a laborer, you know, as a member of this society. And so, you know, I think that that original idea already had problematic manifestations as it in the time that it was built, you know. So at the time, only certain people could even be citizens. So that already had a limitation on who was accepted into school. And we've seen school become a different thing for all those who weren't in that original vision of school. We've seen indigenous folk who were, school was used as a place of assimilation. We've seen, school and, as a place to instill an authoritarian relationship with folks of color and the authority figures that were teachers that were most often to this day, majority white. Mm-hmm. And so I think that, one of the pieces that's necessary is to address that foundation. I used to be a college advisor working with students in Providence, and I was working with juniors and seniors with the college application process. And I remember I was, for a lot of students, the moment that they understood that they were undocumented was sitting with me, us filling out the FAFSA and asking for certain documents, and then being like, I don't think I have that. I've never needed that. And I was that person that had to walk with them through understanding what being undocumented meant.
Right.
Obviously, that's not a conversation many of them, their parents ever really explained to them, and they didn't, have a need to know what that meant. They just know, I didn't have a passport, I couldn't do certain, they didn't know how much of a barrier this would be. And they just didn't know that that was a component of their identity. And so, when we think about, school, who's it for and who's it not, we still haven't even really addressed those questions to this day. Mm-hmm. How about supporting all those whose school is supposed to be there for? And so the second or the first, part of the question is, how do we, have these different conversations and think about school and school choice, differently. I think once we, one, start to focus on making sure schools are actually places for everyone, and maybe having schools that support and, attend to different needs, we can start to have more agency and decision-making. I too had a decision between one school and the other. Luckily, I guess, to an extent, because my parents had instilled this idea of education, I watched my two older brothers end up, being incarcerated early on, having issues in their schools and understanding where those issues were coming from. I was very like, I need to make sure I'm in the right environment, because if not, I can end up this way or that way. So I chose to go to a charter school when I was at my assigned middle school. And the first day of school, like, there were folks with knives out at the bus stop. It's kids, and having a pocket knife isn't, but when you haven't been exposed to that, you're seeing that, you're like,
that's different.
Here. And it was experience that I wasn't really, I didn't feel safe,
right,
in my originally assigned middle school. And most students find a way to just cope with that and deal with that, whether it's, okay, well, I need to present myself in a more, in a way that's going to make sure no one punks me. Mm-hmm. That's one, some people take. And others is like, let me just avoid this or that, or let me just not go to school altogether. Mm-hmm. And so I was able to choose to be in another school. But that's not a choice, many have the support and resources to be able to consider. So I think the other part is like really, asking, and thinking about what is the best environment for young people. Mm. Let young people be a part of that conversation. I think in this play, we're able to see in the end, what choice do you want? I want to go outside. And, to be able to have options that are like, there, right now we have vocational and we have traditional schooling, right? Like, for those who, are more inclined to, want more physical activity as a part of their lived experience, right? We talk about play. When you talk about like education, that's a huge part. People's minds are stimulated differently. And so I think that we just need a more kind of individually centered kind of thought about schooling in order to have outcomes that are better on individual.
Yeah. I want to, we could talk about this forever, but I want to make one observation, and then sort of like tie it together. So one of the things that I think is really interesting about this project overall is just how connected the themes are. So we are talking about education. The play is really talking about, well, how do we make these decisions? Where, like, is it a student choice thing? Is it a parent choice thing? Do we have an actual choice? And one of the things it occurs to me is how much community is rooted in the way folks will sort of find their way to a strong education. So I think about, there's housing inequality. And so if we have housing issues and therefore we're not able to structurally support community in that way, what does it mean for the educational system? Like, all of these things sort of like bounce up against the other thing constantly.
Yeah, I mean, we know things like, you know, your zip code determining your, you know, trajectory. We know that there are more components that are involved. You can't learn effectively on an empty stomach. Can't really participate in all the strain of all the intellectual strain that, you know, school involves in challenging yourself. If you're dealing with other mental strains or physical, you know, strains, we know that students are misdiagnosed as needing special or being special needs, mm-hmm. without necessarily knowing what that need is, and then kind of grouped together. So all these, you know, health and housing, and, you know, other, you know, kind of areas of students' lives and who they are play such dominant roles, yet, you know, we're just told education is the key.
Right.
You know, it's the only real thing as a young person that, you know, you're told you need to focus on, you know, you need to learn. And, you know, people are dealing with real issues and real concerns and don't have the resources for it. And so I think that, like, that is such a big problem, you know, with how we just focus on education, where we, you know, just have students much like the work, you know, world. And that's, you know, where my kind of capitalism critique comes in, where, you know, that's, you know, and also the original, what are schools for? If they're just preparing people to be productive members of society, there are jobs and industries that say, you have no excuses. Mm. You know, you're work and produce. And we can't really account for, you know, your home situation or your health situation. And so schools are very much, you know, mimicking that, you know, kind of system. In very problematic ways. And so it just kind of weeds out, the same way jobs kind of kick out those who aren't, those who can produce. Right. So, you know, that's where the community, you know, considerations come in. And the question is, well, who's it on in the community to take these onto themselves? Do we have these institutions that have the level of funding that, you know, our schools have to be able to, you know, take care of, you know, people in the ways that they need? Do we have, you know, hospitals or community health centers, and, you know, job centers and recreational facilities that can provide these other things? You know, their models, you know, I'm not as familiar, but knowing things like the Harlem Children's Zone, ways that have really said, let's make sure that this whole neighborhood is a place that is connected to the child's, young people's educational journeys. So I'm a big fan of and an advocate for, you know, really community-based models and integrated community-established systems and institutions that can provide these wraparound supports for students, but there's a huge need for the resources to do that effectively.
Yes, 100%. Before we wrap up, can you just say a little bit more about your work and sort of like what brings you to this conversation?
Yeah. Well, what brought me is a good friend who is an artist and is a true maverick in education, and someone who inspired me, Oompa Williams, who, you know, we taught together supported young people together through Breakthrough Collaborative. And, you know, that has always been my general focus. Para los niños, I would say it's always been about young people. And as a young person who, again, I mentioned my siblings, I was the first of my, I had my two older brothers. I was the first of them to graduate from high school because they had been incarcerated by the time they had, before they got their diplomas. And so I was like, why does this happen? Why do some, you know, get the chance to graduate or get out of high school and go to college, and others who are, we have the same housing situation, same zip code, same everything, all these factors were the same, but choices and the way schools responded to us dramatically affected our trajectories. So, you know, I think about my situation where you have someone who, you know, is Ivy League educated and currently, you know, able to be successful in all the ways, meanwhile has a brother who's serving two life sentences. And, you know, we can cut all this, like, you know, if you just work hard and you stay focused and you know, that's not it. As someone who has succeeded in the traditional way, it wasn't determination and focus. It was a series of lucky, blessed, random opportunities. Black women who my teachers who said, boy, cut that out. And it could have been another teacher who would have, instead of saying, boy, cut that out, saying, get out of my classroom.
Right.
That one difference and what one person said versus the other can affect an entire trajectory. So now my work is, I'm at MIT pursuing a dual degree in city planning and MBA. And, you know, it's to figure out how these systems work, how do communities orient themselves, develop the resources, find the systems, get the public amenities, work with what we understand to be the driving interest of how this current, you know, system is set up, where capital has such a strong, you know, say in how our communities are set up.
Thank you so much. And thank you for sharing your thoughts and your words with us, Aya. Much appreciate it. And to all the partners and artists who have joined us for Remaking America, an inaugural message to the new administration. You can find more information about the participants in our event via the links in the chat. Throughout the program, you've heard from artists and activists who are working toward a better future. We hope you'll join us in this work, because the only way to do it is together.
We'd also love for you to check out our next Open Write, a free public program for writers that brings in accomplished guest artists from around the country for guided conversation and dedicated communal writing time. Our next session is Saturday, February 20th, and they occur monthly. Mark your calendar and RSVP on our website.
Please consider making a donation to Company One Theater in order to support future events as we continue to build community at the intersection of art and social change. To donate, please visit companyone.org/donate. You'll also find that link and our Venmo handle in the description for this video.
Finally, if you are fired up and ready to take action on these issues, be sure to check out our event page, which is also linked in the video description, to find resources and the steps you can take in your community and within your own circles.
Thanks again for joining us to imagine a better future for all of us. We'll see you next time.